Well, if you want to get your Bibles, please, and open to Luke chapter 3. It's our gospel reading for this third Sunday of Advent. And some of y'all looks like going to beat the preacher there. All right, Luke chapter 3, beginning at verse 7. John said to the crowds coming out to be baptized by him, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath? Produce fruit in keeping with repentance, and do not begin to say yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our father.' For I tell you that out of these stones, God can raise up children for Abraham. The axe is already at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire." "What should we do then?" the crowd asked. John answered, "Anyone who has two shirts should share with one who has none. Anyone who has food should do the same. Even tax collectors came to be baptized." "Teacher," they said, "what should we do?" "Don't collect any more than you are required to," he told them. Then some soldiers asked him, "And what should we do?" He replied, "Don't extort money and don't accuse people falsely. Be content with your pay." The people were waiting expectantly and were all wondering in their hearts if John might possibly be the Messiah. But John answered them all, "I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I will come, straps of whose sandals I'm not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his barn. But he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire." And with many other words, John exhorted the people and proclaimed the good news to them. And now, God, give us all grace that I can speak and we can all hear the truth of these words. In Jesus we pray. Amen. Excuse me for my voice problems this morning. You know, in the last few weeks, my voice has got a whole lot better. So I didn't think those voice exercises were doing me any good, so I quit doing them. But guess what? They were working, and I got to get back on schedule. John the Baptist was preaching out in wilderness area, remote area, away from the city, and he began to attract big crowds, and they'd come from all over the region to hear him preach. Now, this was certainly not because of his light, comforting, and entertaining sermons. As you heard, they were quite harsh. Our text gives an example of that preacher. It's a stern call to repentance and holiness. And that would be in the tradition of the ancient prophets of Israel. Now, I think sometimes the crowd were probably coming because prophecy had just about disappeared. There was no renowned prophet like Elijah, Elisha, Moses. No one like it. For 400 years, there had been no prophet in Israel. Well, Malachi, the last prophet, had prophesied that a prophet like Elijah would come to prepare a way for the Messiah. And John sure fits that description. There's an Old Testament description of John, how he wore a leather belt around his waist and how he was dressed. And John just fit the bill. And so crowds were coming out to hear him. They'd been waiting for Messiah for a long time. And they believed that Messiah was going to free them from foreign powers and reestablish Israel as a leader among the nations. But listen to what John said, the one coming after him was going to do when he came. In verse 15 and 17, he said, he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and gather the wheat into his barn, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. Kind of frightening, isn't it? The Christians have often associated unquenchable fire with the judgment of God. And the Bible directly does that on occasion. But this fire is in conjunction with the baptism of the Holy Spirit, which does not evoke images of judgment at all. Although fire is used as a symbol of judgment, it is also used as a symbol of purity, holiness, and sanctification. And surely that's what this text is about. It's interesting that John said Jesus will baptize us with the Holy Spirit and fire. It's not an either or deal. You don't just take the baptism of the Holy Spirit or the fire. It's like they're two sides of the same coin. They're inseparable. They come together. But you know, I've had many people ask me to pray with them for the baptism in the Holy Spirit. But not once has anyone come and asked me to pray for me, preacher. I want the baptism of fire. Nobody wants that one. Now, some have asked me to pray with them. But, you know, I need to make some changes in my life, that God would help me be holy, but not in terms of fire baptism. Because I said, it sounds kind of scary, doesn't it? Now, the meaning of this text has to be found in what John said earlier. He said his winnowing fork, what the text said about John the Baptist, his winnowing fork is in his hand. Now, that's the Messiah that he's announcing. His winnowing fork is in his hand. What does it mean to winnow? Is that a word y'all use a lot? It means to separate the chaff from the grain by means of a current of air. Or it means to rid of undesirable parts. The undesirable part in this context is the chaff. And the chaff are dry bracts or scales things that enclose mature grains of wheat. You get them all the time when you eat popcorn, right? You get caught in your teeth. It's an undesirable part of the wheat. Well, after harvesting, the chaff becomes unnecessary and it diminishes the desirability of the grain. So it is removed before selling or grinding the grain through the process of winnowing. Now, we have mechanical processes to do that now, machines to do it. But this is a picture of primitive winnowing. You see they still practice that some in the Middle East. They get a fork and they throw that wheat up in the air when there's a good wind blowing. And the shaking of it shakes those bracts free and the wind blows them away. And that's the image that we have of the Messiah that's going to come with his winnowing fork in his hand. Now, after the winnowing is completed, he says it's thrown into the fire. I think maybe they used it as kindling for fires because it's very combustible. The point is this. The unquenchable fire doesn't burn up the wheat. It burns up the chaff. That which is undesirable. People have something like chaff, don't they? Amen. You know all about your spouse or your children or your neighbors or your friends' chaff. We usually don't know too much about our own chaff, but we know about other people's. Now, it could be, and that chaff I'm talking about something that's unnecessary, and it's probably a negative part of our living. It could be pride, prejudice, arrogance, anger, fear, low self-esteem, anything like sin of any kind, and any number of other things that just, they tend to keep us from God and separate us from other people. And God wants to get rid of it because he wants us to be able to do and to be what he desires. Often, all we see is the chaff, right? There are just some people we just see the chaff, and we don't be around them, won't have anything to do with them. But listen to Isaiah chapter 11, the second part of verse 3. He says, he's talking about the righteous branch that God's going to raise up, the Messiah. He says, he will not judge by what he sees. He's not going to judge you by your chaff that's so readily visible at first sight. He's not going to judge you by what he sees with his eyes or decide by what he hears with his ears. In other words, he's not going to decide anything about you by what he hears from other people. Yeah, that's good news, isn't it? Amen. Jesus sees our chaff, but he doesn't judge us by it or by what people say about us. He sees the kernel of wheat inside. He sees what we can be in Jesus Christ. Jesus baptizes us with fire to burn away the chaff. This is not a judgment text. And I said, it's a baptism of the Holy Spirit and fire. We'll not be baptized in the Holy Spirit unless and until we're willing to be baptized with the fire. Maybe that's why we don't see the evidence of miracles as much in the church as we used to. It's what Wesley thought. He said the reason the gifts were withdrawn is because we well nigh lost everything having to do with holiness and righteousness. Well, what is the fire exactly? Well, it can be a lot of things, but I think generally it's just life. Living in a fallen world where bad things happen to even good people, plus the fact that our world demands what from us? The world demands that you follow its ways, right? Have you noticed sometimes that the way of Jesus doesn't really stay in step with the beat of the drum that the world's pounding? Sometimes, most of the time, the world's out of step with Jesus. And to be in step with Jesus means we're out of step with the world. And that brings judgment from people, disgust, rejection. So God tells us that through Paul in Romans 12, 1 and 2, listen to what it says. Do not conform any longer to the pattern that's in the world. In other words, don't go the way the world wants to go. But be renewed by the renewal of your mind. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Let God transform your thinking so you won't think the way the world does. You'll think the way God does, and that will lead you to behave the way God wants you to behave. You know, this creates conflict and struggles for Christians, which God uses that conflict to perfect us in holiness. Listen to what God said through the prophet Isaiah in chapter 48, verse 10. He said, see, I have refined you, though not as silver. I have tested you in the furnace of affliction. God uses the struggles and difficulties in this world to get rid of the chaff in us so that we can become everything God desires for us. Now, time after time, we see God refining his people, using the difficulties to do that, to purify us. To me, it was a horrible thing It took the death of my daughter, my best friend. And I lived in the crucible of suffering for 2 years. God was using it. God didn't cause those things, but God wanted to use those things to help get rid of some chaff that was keeping me from surrendering to God. Now, please don't hear me wrong. I'm not saying that God causes death and injury and problems in our world. No. But he knows they're going to happen. When he sees them, he uses them to change our lives and to make us different. Now, God knows our nature. He knows that we are most likely to turn to him when we're at the end of our rope. It is in the crucible of difficulty and suffering that we learn to trust God and his faithfulness. Romans 8:28 may be one of the most important verses in the Bible. It says this, "And we know, not that we think or we hope or suspect, but we know that God causes all things to work together for good for those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose." God doesn't cause the things, but he causes the things. He uses them in our lives, causes them to work for good in us. You know, we can endure most anything, I believe, if we're confident it will ultimately work for our good and for the good of the world. God wants us to face life unafraid, to attack life with the reckless abandon of people who know the truth of this scripture, that God uses everything that happens to us as raw material for our sanctification. Now, we all know that fire can be good or bad depending on how it's used, right? Amen. Under control, it gives warmth, comfort, and provides a means of cooking our food. But out of control, it can burn up forests, homes, destroy lives. Malachi 3:2 tells us that Jesus is going to be like a refiner's fire. Now, to tell you a little bit about refining, they get gold ore or silver ore. You know, they find it in clumps of rock, and they put it in a bowl that can stand the heat. They put a fire under it until it melts. And as it melts, the dross, the impurities in the gold or silver, separate from it. And they have an instrument then that they pull out the dross and discard it. Then they turn the heat up a little bit higher, see? And some more dross will separate, and they skim it out. And the trick is to get the gold or silver as pure as possible without scorching it. Because if you scorch it, it decreases in value, the color changes. And so the refiner has got to be an expert. You think about working with primitive tools, it would be a hard thing to do. Now, God allows evil to remain in the world. He permits things to happen in our life that we don't understand. But we got to remember that God is a skilled craftsman. He is always in control. Amen. We got to know that God is always in control. He is never out of control. He knows what he's doing. And he wants us to trust him, to believe, Romans 8:28, that he's using those to remove dross or to get the scales, the chaff, away from our lives to make us fit for his coming kingdom. We need to learn to trust God, because unlike the silver or the gold that's being refined, we have free will. God didn't take that away from us. We can jump out of the pot if we want to. And a lot of us do. We don't want to do that. We don't want to be refined in the fire. I lived 2 miserable years before I finally threw up my hand and said, "Okay, God, if you want, I've messed up the last, I can't remember how old I was then, 25, 30 years of my life. If you want my life now, the rest of it, you can have it. I don't want it. It's brought me nothing but heartache and misery." I've been jumping out of the pot for years. We want God to save us from life's problems. But God wants to save us through life's problems, contradictions, and pain. That's the message of the cross. Remember with me now the story of three Jewish boys named Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. If you've been in Sunday school much, you heard that story. These three boys were taken in captivity, and Nebuchadnezzar's officials wanted to get rid of these Jewish boys because they were smart. God was on their side, showing them up. And he got him to make this idol. Say, if you don't bow down and worship this idol, you're going to get thrown in the fiery pit. He made a big furnace just for that purpose. Well, the three Jewish boys wouldn't do it, and they got thrown in the fire. Now listen to what it said in Daniel 3:25. He, meaning the king, looks in the furnace after he's thrown those three boys in there, and he said, look, I see four men walking around in the fire, unbound and unharmed, and the fourth looks like a son of the God. Jesus was in there with them. And guess what? The only thing that burned up were the ropes that bound them. When we say to Jesus, oh, the fire's too hot, it'll burn me, he says, trust me. But we say, oh, Jesus, you don't understand. You need to walk a mile in my shoes. He says, here, look, I have walked a mile in your shoes. I learned obedience through the things I suffered. Should it be any different for you? Jesus never asks us to go where he hasn't already been. And anywhere he asks us to go, he goes with us. Amen. This is one of the central purposes, you see, of the incarnation of God becoming a person, a human being like us. God identified with us, including our pain and the temptation to sin. He said Jesus knew every temptation we knew, only he was without sin. God did all that so we could identify with him in all his. He identified with us in all of our pain so we could identify with him in all his glory. I heard a story once. A little boy was walking in the park and he found a bird with a bad leg. I don't know if it was broken or what, but he couldn't get going enough to get flight. And the little boy picked him up and Bert was squirming, afraid, trying to get away from this big thing that's picked him up. And the boy was stroking him, you know, trying to calm him down. And this lady saw this thing unfold. She came over and said, son, why don't you let me take the bird? I can probably do more for it than you can. He said, no, thank you, ma'am. I think I can do more for him because I know how he feels. And as he walked away, she noticed the brace on his leg. God became a man in Jesus of Nazareth. He walked a mile in our shoes so we could know that Jesus knows our every hurt, every disappointment, every temptation, every frustration, every discouragement that we have. He's been there. He suffered rejection and pain. Amen. The meanness of people. He knows how we feel. Matthew 5:48 is clear, and these are the words of Jesus. Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. It is no easy road to Christian perfection, but God will not settle for less. So the fire of God is unquenchable. He desires and demands the best for us, the best in us and the best from us. He intends to burn up the chaff so the wheat can be gathered into his barn. He couldn't truly love us and be any other way, could he? Isn't that what we want for our children? We want them to be and do the very best they're capable of. The beauty of it all is he loves us so much. He walks through the fire with us. And he is in control. We need have no fear. Only the chaff, the things that bind us, will be burned up. Only enough heat will be applied to refine his gold. The gold will be pure, but never scorched. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we all know the difficulty of living in a fallen world. We've all experienced life's hurts. We've experienced rejection from others. We've experienced sin, doing things that we just hate that we have done. We know we've hurt others. We've had to look into the gaping jaws of death to see loved ones depart this life. We've known all these things. And God, we need healing and wholeness. We need you to walk with us each and every day so that all these things do not overcome us, but they're things that we use as stepping stones to become better people, to be strengthened in our resolve to be like Jesus. So come now, Lord, and help us to realize that the fire of God is not our enemy if we belong to God. The fire of God is our friend that will burn up the chaff so the wheat that is the human that God has placed inside these bodies will be gathered into his barn for all eternity. So help us, Lord, to stay in the pot, to not jump out, but to let you have your way with us. And I don't know what kind of issues we might be dealing with this morning. Each of you brings your own problems and pain to this service. But I want you to know at this altar you find healing. Yes, God is with you. He's in your heart. He's on the pew with you. But he's constantly dealing with your pride that will not let him do what he wants to do in you. And I found for me at least, when I'm in a church service, if I get up from all those people and walk down to the altar, my pride won't go with me. It stays in the pew. So I have a much better chance of receiving from God at the altar. So God is here today. He wants to heal you. He wants to encourage you. He wants to strengthen you. He wants you to be and become everything he created you to be. So you come if you need prayer. You ask God. Those who ask, receive. Those who seek, find. Those who knock, find the door open to them. If they keep on asking, keep on seeking, and keep on knocking. So the altar is open for you to come. If you want me to pray with you, lift your hand. Otherwise, I'll respect your privacy. Let you do your own business with God. Let's stand together as we sing.